All right, welcome to Philippians. Philippians is a book that was written to basically thank a church that had been very helpful in Paul's ministry. They supported him financially, and Paul is writing to them as a thank you note, but maybe even more than that, he's writing to them a letter of great encouragement. Key word for the book of Philippians seems to be joy. He gets into that word as early as verse 4 when he's talking about his joy that he has in prayer for them. And then it works its way all throughout. It comes in three basic ways. One is Paul's joy. Secondly is their joy. And third is a command to rejoice, or rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice, as we well know. But here Paul is talking about, in chapter 1, the circumstances. He's in prison, but he has joy. Why? Because he sees the gospel is being furthered, and so he takes great joy, not in his circumstances, but in who Christ is. And that's a real key to us, is our need for joy because of who Christ is and our relationship with him, and taking joy in the things of the kingdom of God and the furtherance of the gospel. And then he talks about, in chapter 2, 1 through 13, he says that I need to have joy by knowing that you all are unified in the same mind. What kind of mind? The mind of humility that we see in the Lord Jesus Christ. So he goes in here to talking. This is one of those Christological passages I talked about. And you're going to do a discussion board on it. So I'm going to leave that for you to look in more detail. But a wonderful passage about the Lord Jesus Christ's in his deity, his suffering, and his exaltation. And then we have joy in suffering and fellowship, where he talks about his fellowship with Timothy and Epaphroditus. And then he talks about joy that presses on towards the goal. And just he doesn't get discouraged and down to the point of quitting. He always continues to press on. If you notice my emails, I sign off on most of my emails either press on or pressing on. And I do this because there's two commands that we're called to do every day. I'll mention quickly here. One is to take up your cross daily. That means to take up your part in the kingdom of God, to do the work of the kingdom. Jesus' part was to die on the cross. Ours is to carry the cross forward in the year 2015. But the second command is to do daily is to encourage one another day by day. And I think God knows that if we're going to take up the cross, we need other people encouraging us to do that. So he says, press on toward the goal. I press on. I keep doing this. You need to keep doing this too, he's telling them. And then there's joy in their concern. And here, this is just the thank you part of it. Verse 13 of chapter 4 is kind of misquoted a lot, misused. Put it in context here when he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. The context is he's saying, look, I've been hungry and I have been full. I've been in poverty and I've been in abundance. And I've learned that whatever circumstances I am, to be content. And therefore, he's saying, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can take, not taking what I want and putting Jesus' name at the end and saying I'm naming and claiming it, okay? But I can take the circumstances God brings to me and I can do it because Christ will strengthen me in it. So put that in context there. That's Philippians. Let's go over to Colossians real quick here. Colossians is a small town. It's not a town that Paul ever visited, as far as we know. But in Colossae, it gets its name, means large, from mountains that it's in, nestled in the pass of. And as Paul is writing to them, he's actually writing a letter, we'll look at in a moment, to Philemon, but who lives there in Colossae. But he's also wants to deal with some heresies that are going on in Colossae. And so he starts off by talking about them, praying for them, how he prays for them. Don't skip over those parts, they're so rich. Then he goes into the supremacy of Christ. Very crucial. He's going to lay a foundation for who Jesus is before he takes and goes into talking about the the situations, the heresies that are going on, because they'll make more sense. I'm getting into it too much. You're going to cover that in your discussion board. I'll leave that to you to finish up that last sentence. Then he takes a look, and Paul talks about his stewardship he's received. Here he talks about the fact that he is in wanting to see the church grow. He's wanting to see the church grow deep, and he's wanting the individuals to grow in Christ. And he says that there's this mystery of the kingdom that I'm so passionate about, and that is Christ in you, the hope of glory. Real quick, two additional verses to bring in. Numbers 14:21. Numbers 14:21 says, "As surely as I live, declares the Lord of hosts, the whole earth will be filled with the glory of the Lord." God swears by his own existence that the earth is going to be filled with his glory. Does that mean the Shekinah glory is just going to glow? I don't believe so. I believe this is the glory that Paul speaks to the Corinthians, that we are all being transformed into the image of Christ from one degree of glory to another. And so Paul's saying here that Christ in you is the hope of glory, that in essence you get saved. The Holy Spirit of God comes in you. The very character of Jesus Christ is formed in you. And it overflows. What do I mean by the character of Christ? I mean his love, his goodness, his patience, his holiness, his joy, all the aspects of the fruit of the Spirit, his righteousness. All these things come into us and fill us, and the hope is that the glory of God through these divine attributes would shine through us to the world around us. And it'll come and it'll affect somebody else. And that other person will take the gospel into their lives, and they will be filled with the glory of God. And they will then have the glory overflow into someone else's life. And on it goes from people group to people group, nation to nation, until the whole earth is filled with the glory of the Lord. Well, that's what Paul's hope is. That's his stewardship. Then he deals with the heresies of Colossae. Some break it down to two heresies. Some break it down to three. Note here that this is going to be part of the reason Paul sets up his purpose in writing to them. Then he's got the saints. He talks about the victory we have there. And then lastly, serving Christ in relationships. Let me go to Philemon here. I'm about out of time, but Philemon, as I mentioned before, he's a slave owner. He's a businessman. And he's got a slave whose name was Onesimus, who ran away. Now, Paul says that Onesimus owed him something. I don't know if that could have been one of two things. Either he was a indentured servant. Onesimus owed a debt. Philemon paid it off. And now Onesimus is working off his debt. Or maybe Onesimus stole something from him when he ran away. Well, Onesimus runs away to Rome, where there's lots of slaves. It's easy to blend in. He gets saved, comes across the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul hears what's going on, realizes that he's got some connections back there to Onesimus, and says, "I'm sending you back." But here's the key. He tells Philemon, "I'm sending him back no longer as just a slave, but even more, as a brother." Paul sets up a foundation for the eradication of slavery, not through necessarily war, but through the culture of Christianity coming in salt and light, and recognizing the need to receive people not as just slaves, but as brothers in Christ. And the potential brothers in Christ as well. All right, that's Philemon. We had Philippians, joy and thanksgiving. We had Colossians, the glory of Jesus Christ. And we had Philemon, receive your brother in Christ.